I'm pleased to report that Santa Claus's spirit still exists in the form of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, a great model for us to look at today with hope for a new infrastructure bank. The Reconstruction Finance Corporation was started by Republican President Herbert Hoover, for after 3 years of declaring the Depression will end, the economy is sound, we should all volunteer to help each other, said that it was time to use the power of government to solve the catastrophe of the Great Depression. So he started the Reconstruction Finance Corporation during his last year in office to make loans to banks, insurance companies, and railroads, thinking that would restore confidence and end the Great Depression. In fact, it was so successful during his last year in office, he expanded its lending authority to almost the size of the entire federal budget at that time, which was only $4 billion. Nonetheless, he kept enlarging it because it was working so well. Nonetheless, one of its board members, Jesse Jones, would later say, if Hoover had started the RFC, the nation's vital infrastructure bank, 2 years before, and had judiciously loaned $5 to $7 billion, the worst of the Great Depression could have been avoided. When Franklin Roosevelt became president, he made Jesse Jones its chairman and he supercharged the RFC. Congress, within days of his inauguration, passed legislation to allow the RFC to buy preferred stock in banks to recapitalize them so they could lend again. And it's important to know that when Roosevelt was inaugurated, all the banks were closed. The financial system had completely collapsed. Unemployment was 25%. Gross national product had been sliced in half. Stocks had lost 75% of their value. Suicide rates had tripled. So the RFC was able to start buying preferred stock in banks to recapitalize them so they could lend again. That same strategy was duplicated in 2008 during the Great Recession, known as TARP, the Troubled Asset Relief Program. It was modeled precisely on what Jesse Jones and the RFC did in 1933. The trouble was, in 1933, the banks had all this new money from selling their preferred stock to the government, but they were sitting on the cash. They were petrified to use that money to put it out into the economy. So Jesse Jones and Roosevelt said, if you don't start lending this money, the RFC will have to step in and be the lender of last resort. And that's exactly what it did. After that, the Reconstruction Finance Corporation, through lending, not spending, and that's the important distinction of the RFC and the new proposed infrastructure bank, the RFC saved thousands of homes, farms, banks, and businesses. It financed the development of high-speed rail. It built bridges, tunnels, aqueducts, and highways. It developed water systems in cities so they had safe drinking water, an issue that we are confronting today. And it brought electricity to rural America when 20% of the population there had power. 80% did not. They lived in the dark. And then it helped them buy appliances so they could plug into the modern age through credit, through lending. And what's so interesting about all of this, all of these massive programs during the worst economic catastrophe in our nation's history made money for the federal government, much like a new infrastructure bank can do today. It can fill the gap for President Biden's new infrastructure legislation, which is wonderful. I'm so happy that it was passed, but we will find that it is inadequate. It will not fulfill the needs of our nation's vitality like an infrastructure bank can do. It can fill the gap by lending instead of spending. In fact, the RFC was so successful through its lending that it helped finance Roosevelt's spending programs like the WPA and the PWA, which we will hear from Dr. Hopkins in just a moment. And Roosevelt's programs and the RFC's strategies worked. Within 4 years of Roosevelt's inauguration by 1936, Detroit was turning out more cars in 1936 than it had in 1929. Unemployment dropped by 8%, and industrial output had doubled. And all the while, war is spreading in Europe, and the United States was completely unprepared. Our military at the time ranked 17th in the world. Germany had 9,000 airplanes, Japan had 7,500 airplanes, and we had about 2,500 antiquated airplanes that were left over from World War I. And Roosevelt's hands were tied, but he knew he needed to act. Neutrality acts prevented him from selling arms to warring nations, and the public was vehemently opposed to intervention unless the United States was directly attacked. But thankfully, Roosevelt had his infrastructure bank in Jesse Jones. So a full 18 months before the attacks on Pearl Harbor, Jesse Jones and the RFC began building thousands, literally thousands of massive factories to manufacture the trucks, tanks, airplanes, and ships required to fight and win World War II. And their efforts were comprehensive. In addition to building tens of thousands of airplanes, it was also manufacturing high-octane gas to fuel the planes. It was building schools to train aviators. It cornered the market in silk and wool for uniforms and for parachutes. Everything it did was cohesive. And I can't help but think that if we had managed to corral that kind of power and force at the onset of the coronavirus, what we could have done then, or how we can use that same power to address the more frequent intense weather events. I want to go back to the EHFA, the Electric Home Farm Authority, that helped people buy appliances on credit once they got electricity brought to their homes through the Rural Electrification Administration, because it is a great example of how RFC strategies can be used today. That same mechanism can be used to help people retrofit their homes so they're energy efficient, storm resistant, and wired for the digital age. You can spread broadband across the nation through this kind of strategy, and then you can help people through lending, buy devices to plug into the modern age, just like the RFC did back in the 1930s. And it made money when it did it for the federal government. So the United States was able to mobilize their forces and support the Allied forces to win World War II. Maybe one of the most amazing feats was it developed synthetic rubber, again, 18 months before the attacks on Pearl Harbor, when the Japanese took our supply of natural rubber. So the RFC got together the heads of corporations, universities, and scientists and figured out how to manufacture the substance. It built the plants, it leased them to corporations, which is how it manufactured and produced everything that it did during World War II. And I kind of chuckle when people, you know, laugh and think about good government as socialism. And I think, well, how do they imagine World War II was won? It was through the power of good government in concert with corporations. And the RFC had every ability or every opportunity to nationalize banks during the Great Depression, to nationalize industry during World War II, but that was never its intent. It wanted to save capitalism during the Great Depression and save democracy during World War II, and that's exactly what it did. And the RFC, like an infrastructure bank today, was embraced by liberals, conservatives, Republicans, Democrats, and it made loans in every congressional district in the United States of America. And it was loved by almost everybody. And I think that a new infrastructure bank today, if we embrace it as something patriotic that everybody can benefit from, it will restore the vitality of our nation. That is what we should do. We should look at the RFC as a model for today.